12:2 says, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what the will of God is, and what is good, acceptable, and perfect."
It's your heart we're searching for. We want you and nothing more. Let your glory fill this place.
Heavenly Father, that you would continue to purify us and refine us. And it's in your holy and precious name we pray. Amen. You may.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I want to say that we're glad that you're here. And if you're new, we're really glad that you're here. And if you're new, we have connection cards in the seats right in front of you, or you can fill them out online. This is a way for us to just learn more about you, as well as a way for us to tell you about our church and get you more information about us. So I have a couple of announcements for us this morning. The first one is our partners in Harvest. So mission, this is our annual mission offering. And so We all know, or we should, that we are all called to share the gospel, all of us, every single one of us, with our surrounding community, with Oak Grove. But it's also our responsibility to make sure everywhere in the world gets the gospel as well, and partner with other ministries. And so make sure you look at your announcements. It tells you what that missions offering goes towards, what missions we're helping with. And so pray about it. Give generously. This helps spread the gospel, not just here, but also to the ends of the earth. Second announcement I have for us this morning is we have a women's retreat October 13th and 14th. And so tickets are available in the fellowship hall. So you can look at your announcements for more information about that. But tickets are available for the women's retreat in the fellowship hall today. The next announcement I have is we have an Experiencing God study starting September 12th. This is a church-wide study, so we want anyone and everyone to be a part of it. Even you students, we're going to have a group for them as well. But everyone can be a part of this study. And so this will start September 12th. It'll be Sunday nights from 5:30 to 7 p.m. And it'll be a 12-week study, a great way to just come together as a body and learn and grow together. And lastly, related to youth stuff, we have a back-to-school bash September 6th. And so this is just our first Wednesday in September, kind of launching off our school year. It's going to be a fun fellowship event where we're going to have snow cones and food and some games and activities. And then we're also just going to share what our youth ministry is about and invite them to come back next week as we begin to study and learn from God's Word. So that is the announcements that I have for you this morning. Make sure you check your bulletin and our emails and different things. For other information, there's more information out there for you guys. Go ahead and pray with me as we begin worship today. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for bringing us here. Lord, once again, we as a church just submit to you. Lord, you are good and you are God. I pray that you would just guide us in this time of worship. Help us to lay down our burdens at your feet and put our faith once in you. Lord, please just help us hear your word and apply it to our lives today. Thank you for this time. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now we have children's spotlight.
Kids. So, I have a question for you guys this morning. What happens if you eat a whole bunch of salty food, like, I don't know, chips or like goldfish crackers or french fries or something like that? What happens when you eat a whole bunch of those kind of things? Do you know? What else do you want? You just, yeah, go ahead. What are you? Water. You want water too, right? You don't want to just eat a whole bunch of salty chips and you're like, man, that was good. And then you're, a few minutes later, you're like, wait, actually, I want some water with that. Like, if I gave you guys goldfish crackers on Wednesday nights, you guys would be really mad if I didn't give you water with it, right? You would, like, eat all the crackers and be like, Miss Katie, where's our water? Like, what are you doing, right? You would need the water, too, to help, right? Because the salt makes you thirsty, right? If you ever anything super salty, you always want something, you want water or something to drink with it because it makes you thirsty, right? Does that make sense? Yeah? So... I think it's kind of, that's a good application to keep in mind when Jesus is talking about us being salty. So Matthew 5 verses 13 through 16 says, you are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. So, our salt, the way that we act, our actions and our love should make other people want to get to know Jesus better when they hang out with you. Just kind of like when you eat salty food, you want water. The way that we act, the way that we love, should make people want to get more of Jesus. They're like, oh, those people, look at the way that they're acting and the way that they're showing love and the way that they're being kind and the way that they are caring about me and showing me that they love me. I want to know Jesus better because of them, but I want to know Jesus better because of what they're doing. But is that easy to act like that all the time? Sometimes we mess up, right? But that's okay, because God will forgive us, and so do, hopefully so do our friends. When we mess up, we're able to go to them, right? And I wasn't acting like Jesus when I did that. I'm really sorry about that, right? And hopefully they'll forgive us if they're good friends. And we know that Jesus always forgives us, because that's kind of what he does. That's his thing. So I encourage you guys, as you are starting school, especially, I know that, you know, this is a good time of starting fresh and making good decisions and being able to act like Christ as you're interacting with people again pretty on a regular basis in school and stuff, sports and stuff like that. You guys have the opportunity to make people want to get to know Jesus better when you're showing them love like Jesus would. So does that make sense? Yeah? Good? Okay, I'm going to pray for us. God, I just thank you for these kids this morning, and I thank you for just the place in life where they are at. They are able to show your love to people around them, and when they learn this young, God, it becomes habit as they get older. And so I pray that you will just continue to teach them and teach them how to show love to others and to encourage them in that, as they know it's not always easy and we mess up and we make mistakes, but you always forgive us and you give us the strength to keep going and to make better decisions next time. And so I pray that you will just be with each one of us, with the kids and with the adults as well, as we go into the world, that we will show your love to those around us, that they will desire to see you and get to know you better, God. In your name I pray. Amen. Amen. Let's go ahead and stand as we continue to worship our Heavenly Father.
Thank you.
drift away, and I simply come. Only just to bring something that's a word that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required.
Christ. And Lord, I thank you that you continue to refine. And even when we backslide, you will pull us out of the muck and mire. And you remind us that we are yours. You say it's okay. Your students are as far as the east is from the west. Lord, you are worthy of praise. Lord, we love you. Forgive us for when we have made worship more about a song or the music than you. Lord, I just ask that in this time as we sit at your feet, Lord, that we would draw near to you. Lord, that you would have Holy Spirit move in a mighty way as you speak to us. Lord, we love you so much. Thank you for being with us. It's in your holy and precious name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, church family. look quite lovely today. Just turn around and look at yourselves for a second. That's enough, Lane. Not too close. Not too close. You want to go ahead and turn in your text? We're going to be in Hebrews 5 today. So you can find that. While you're doing that, I'm going to share with you, because we are a family, so I'm going to share something with you that family needs to know. We did have a great family meeting Wednesday night. Some people call it a business meeting. It was good. We had, I don't know, what, 100 and some folks down there, and we had a good time. We laughed. We made fun of people in a good Christian loving way, and we had a good time together. I want to reiterate something Ms. Pauline Graham, our Sunday school director, said at that for all of us. Here, that we have a very desperate need in the body of Christ right now, and that is a desperate need that we would have children and preschool Sunday school teachers. We are in the process of starting a new Sunday school year, that's next Sunday. Yeah, next Sunday, we still have a couple of spots open in preschool and a couple in children. That is not something that can go unmet. That is something that we need the folks to fill that. So I encourage you, as Ms. Pauline did, to pray about that. And if God is tweaking your heart that maybe that is you, and, you know, not just everybody's created for that, but God is calling some people to do that. He is calling some folks within our body of Christ, within this family, to do that. If you think it may be you, if you will see Miss Katie or Miss Pauline, or if you just really can't find anybody better, then you can come find me and I'll help you find Miss Katie or Miss Pauline and do that. That's a very important thing. And we need to be in prayer about that. We need to get those positions filled because those children need to learn about Jesus so they can be salt and light and all those things that Katie talked about. Also want to encourage you to join us for the Experiencing God study starting on Sunday night, September the 10th. As a part of our ongoing discipleship, there's going to be small groups we'll get into. And as Better Brent said, that we will have youth as a part of that as well. So we encourage you to come and be a part of that with us on the 10th. Right now, let's stand together, and we're going to read Hebrews chapter 5. This is what God's Word says there. Every high priest is selected from among men and is appointed to represent them in matters related to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He is able to gently deal with those who are ignorant and going astray, since he himself is subject to weakness. That is why he has to offer sacrifices for his own sins as well as for the sins of the people. No one takes this honor upon himself. He must be called by God just as Aaron was. So Christ also did not take upon himself the glory of becoming a high priest. But God said to him, "You are my son. Today I have become your father." And then he says in another place, "You are a high priest forever in the order of Melchizedek." During the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with loud cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him and was destined by God to be high priest in the order of Melchizedek. We have much to say about this, but it's hard to explain because you are slow to learn. In fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's Word all over again. You need milk and not solid food. Anyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness. But solid food is for the mature, who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. Let's pray. Precious Father, we thank you that your word is alive and it's active and sharper than any two-edged sword as we looked at last week. And Father, this morning we ask that your word, the Bible, your word, Jesus, would come and teach us and instruct us and help us to hear what you have for us. We ask these things in Jesus' powerful name. Amen. You may be seated. Do you remember being in school? For some of us, we have to get in the Wayback Machine and go way back to remember that. But if you remember in school, when someone got called to the office, no matter what reason, they could have been getting the Citizen of the Year Award, but if they got called to the office, as they were coming back or as they were going, the chant would erupt from all the people in the class where they knew that they were at. You got in trouble. a trouble. I had that call a time or two in my life. Or you may be down there for something, you know, that was very honorable, but you get that chant came around. That's exactly what is happening in Hebrews 5. The writer picks up where he left off in Hebrews 4, where Hebrews 4 ends. And he's talking about Jesus as a high priest. And then in 5, he begins to describe Jesus as high priest and his qualifications. And then he very abruptly stops and he begins to scold or challenge the listeners or the readers, kind of where the sermon title came from. They got in trouble. Don't get too cocky because it's coming around for us here in just a minute, right? So let's look and see what Hebrews 5 says. First, it talks about, as we said, Jesus' qualifications in verses 1 to 10. They speak about how Jesus is not only qualified to be high priest, but he is a superior high priest. Remember when we talked in the theme, that the theme of Hebrews is that God speaks, he's speaking to us through his son, and that Jesus is superior. He's superior over all these things. He is, again, a superior high priest. So in verses 1 through 3 begins, the writer, the preacher, begins to talk about the qualifications of a high priest, or the role of a high priest. He reminds the listeners of how the high priest thing works. And you would think that they wouldn't need that because they were Hebrews. They were Jewish. Remember, Hebrews is written to the Jewish people, the Jewish Christians. So they should have a pretty good idea. Maybe he's just reminding them so he can, you know, land some punches later. So he begins to remind them of what the high priest thing is all about. And the first thing he reminds them of is the high priest was selected from among men. The high priest was one of them. He says that he's selected to represent them. The scripture says it matters about God. I would call that spiritual stuff. The high priest was to represent them, to help them in spiritual things, to connect them between man and God. He was also to offer sacrifices for sins. In the Old Testament times, then they would, you know, they had the whole system, the temple and the rams and the doves or whatever it was, and the blood sacrifices and the offering sacrifices and all those things. That was the high priest's job, to offer those on behalf of the people to God, to make that connection. And it was also, it says, that they were selected from among men because they were just like them, then they understood the weakness. They understood the struggle it was to live for God, the struggle to be pure, the struggle that there is sin. They even had to make sacrifices for their own sin before they could go and make sacrifices for the sins of the people. So it's just reminding them of the process and how it works. Jesus is all of those things and more. Jesus is all those things that just said a high priest needs to be and more. As some would say, Jesus is extra. I think I learned that from Chris Bezos, maybe. Jesus is extra. So let's see how. First, he was selected, and we'll see that in verse 5 in just a second, but Jesus was selected to be high priest. He was like us, even though he was all God. He did, as we saw in Hebrews 2, he came down in the form of man so he would understand. He was tempted in every way as we are, yet without sin. So he understands, he gets us, he's sympathetic to our plight. He also offered sacrifice for sin, but not just sacrifices. He was the sacrifice. Hebrews 9 will look and see that he is the once for all time, never needs to be done again, sacrifice for sin. And he needed no sacrifice for himself, like the earthly high priest did, who had to sacrifice for themselves before they went in, because he needed no sacrifice, because Jesus is and was sinless. He is a superior high priest. In Hebrews 5, the writer, the preacher, is talking about that he's superior. Then he goes on to say, to kind of nail down, that he is called by God's pardon. The priest had to be called by God, it says in verse 4. It says, just like Aaron. Aaron was the first high priest, Moses' buddy. He was the first high priest. And all the priests came from the line of Aaron. You know, that's kind of how that worked, as they passed that down. Then it goes on in verses 5 and 6 to say that God the Father is the one who called Jesus. He called him first, not high priest. He called him first in verse 5. He called him son. Jesus was the Son of God, equal with God, a part of the Trinity. He was that first. And then God called him to be high priest in verse 6. Again, Jesus is extra, above, more than, superior. He says also in verse 6 that he was a high priest forever. The high priest of the Old Testament time, they'd have to go through those. They'd do their year rotation, then they move on. And Jesus is forever a high priest. There is no substitute for Jesus. There is no replacement for Jesus. There is nobody coming along who's going to take his place. He is the one and only high priest, the only one we will ever need. And he's of a different order. Not only is he high priest forever, but he's not from the line of Aaron. He's from the order of Melchizedek. Now, we'll get into Melchizedek in Hebrews 7 a little bit more. And his name keeps jumping in all through Hebrews. We've seen it already a couple of times. Melchizedek, excuse me, shows up in the Old Testament, Genesis 14. And he's kind of a mysterious guy. There's not a lot known about him, but he seems to be a big deal because he keeps showing up in the New Testament and all kinds of places. So again, we'll look more about him in Hebrews 7. But Jesus is a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. He is, again, a superior high priest. It also goes on to say that he was submitted, part of his qualifications are in verses 7 and 8, that Jesus was submitted to the Father, to God the Father. It says in verses 7 and 8 that Jesus, while he was here on earth, he cried out with tears and petitions to the one who could save him. He didn't cry out for him to save him, but he did cry out to him because he finally and ultimately said, "Nevertheless, Lord, not my will, but thine be done." But he was able to do that, and he cried out. And the scripture says in verses 7 and 8 that he was heard. Jesus cried out to the Father, and he was heard. Why was he heard? Was he heard because he was son? Well, maybe. But what the scripture says, he was heard because he was, in verse 7, because he was submitted or surrendered to the will of the Father. He was heard because he was in line. His request was in line with what God wanted for him to do. He was asking those things with the proper motive, the proper heart, that he was in line with God. He was surrendered to God and what God was trying to do there. Do you know there's a pretty good lesson for us in that? When we cry out to God with tears and petitions and all those kinds of things, and sometimes we feel like maybe God's not listening, sometimes that's just us. But if we want to be heard, if we want to be heard, a good place for us to be is to be surrendered to God's will. For our life to be in line with what God is wanting to do. For our prayers to be lined up with what God is wanting to do. To pray in the name of Jesus, not by just slapping in Jesus' name on the end of the prayer, but to pray what Jesus would pray. To have our hearts so in tune with God that we're asking for the things that God already wants to do in our lives, then we can be heard and know that. So that's just a good life lesson for us, to surrender our heart. Thank you. I'm not sure that's going to help the problem, but thank you. Then verse 8 goes on to say, he was the Son. He was the Son. Yet he learned obedience and was made perfect. Verse 8 says that he learned obedience and he was made perfect. First thing when you hear that, you go, what? This is Jesus. This is the Son of God. Wasn't he already perfect? Didn't he already know everything because he's God? You know, that he's all-knowing? We dealt with the made perfect part in in Hebrews chapter 2. When we said that when Jesus said he was made perfect, it means he completed the task. He was made complete in that he completed the task that God sent for him. He was already perfect. He was already complete. He didn't need improvement. He just got done with what he came to do. It is finished, and he finished the work on the cross. So what about this learned obedience thing? That he learned obedience. He's the Son of God, doesn't he already know everything? Luke's gospel says that Jesus, when he's talking about Jesus, you know, as a little one, it says that he grew in wisdom and stature, and in favor with God and men. Jesus humbled himself. He emptied himself when he came to earth. So there was some learning there, just as any kid would learn. Anyone would do that process. But ultimately, when it's talking here about learned obedience, it means he experienced the fullness of obedience. He put his obedience, he put his that faith, that trust into full action by going to the cross for us. He fulfilled that obedience. He put it to action. It's one thing to say, yes, I'm obedient. Yes, I'll do that. It's a whole other thing to get up and go do that. Jesus got up and he went and did what he was doing. He put it into full action. He experienced the fullness of that when he suffered and died. And then in verse 9, it goes on to talk about because of that, because of the fullness of his obedience, because he went to the cross, because he learned that, and he, through his suffering, was made complete in that he finished the task. And because of that suffering and death, it makes him the source of eternal life. He is the source of eternal life. He is set apart by God as a high priest, as a mediator between God and man, the one who is to take man and God and get them together. That's exactly what Jesus did. He is the source of eternal life. He is the one that bridged the gap between our sin and what that causes us to be separated from God, and brings us into the presence of God by the shed blood of Christ on the cross. He is the source of eternal life. He is the one that did that. He is the high priest. He is the mediator. He is the one that God set apart to do that. That's who he is. That's what he does. Or as Katie said to the kids, that's kind of his thing. You know, that's who Jesus is. That's what he does. He is the one who brings us to the Father. Only he can do that. Not does he do it. Only he can do that. There is no other way. There is no other way to come into the Father in a right relationship with God the Father except through the mediator that he sent, the extra high priest, the super duper superior high priest. He is the only way for us to come into God's presence. The only way for us to come to right relationship with God. Only he. Then in verses 11 through 14, we get to the sermon title. We have a pause for a scolding. They got in trouble. The verses bring a sudden change. I mean, we're just rocking along and talking about Jesus, and he's a high priest, and he's superior, he's extra, he's all that, and he's the only one, he's capable, he's brought us to, he's the source of eternal life. Woo! And then all of a sudden, in verse 11, it says, we have much to say about this, but it's hard to explain to you. And the preacher is like, he's looking. This is kind of a neat perspective from up here. Because you see stuff. And you can tell when people are connecting with you, and you can tell when they've lost interest. It's like the preacher's preaching along, and he looks out, and everybody's eyes are glazed over. Maybe the ones on the back row fell asleep. Phil? All right, they're still with us. All right, get you. And he says, I want to tell you more. I want to tell you more, but I can't. Because, well, let's look and see what they're in trouble for. Can you imagine when the preacher's doing this? We said in Hebrews, it may well have been preached first and then written down later. Can you imagine the preacher's going along, rocking along, and he looks at him and he goes, I really want to explain more, but you guys are just, I can't. You're too dense. A collective Scooby-Doo kicked in, go, ruh-roh. Ruh-roh, we in trouble now. Why are they in trouble? First of all, he says in verse 11, you're slow to learn. The picture is God is speaking. That's Hebrews. That's the name of Hebrews. God is speaking to you. God is trying to talk to you. He's got this thing to say to you. I'm trying to explain all this to you. But you're slow to learn. You're closing your ears. You stop listening too soon. God's not done talking, but you're done listening. It's like you got your fingers and your ears. You quit too early. God has more to say, but you quit listening too early. Are we ever guilty of that? Are we ever guilty of that? Maybe it'd be better to say it this way. Boy, are we ever guilty of that. We just shut God off. We get bored with what's going on. We get scared of what he's saying. We just get scared of what he's going to say next. We just shut God off before he's done with the process. We don't let God finish his sentence before we take off to whatever's next in our mind. Maybe not what God has done with. So what was the evidence that they had quit listening? What was the evidence they quit listening? Verse 12. By now, you ought to be teachers. By now, you ought to be teachers. You've been doing this following Jesus thing for a while now, guys. And you should by now be a teacher. You should be sharing with others what God is sharing with you. You should be passing on, telling others what you have discovered. You should be sharing the good news. You should be sharing the faith. You should be sharing the truths of that. But instead, you still need someone to tell you the basics. I'm reading it out of the scripture. You still need someone to tell you the basics over and over and over and over and over. I can't help but go to the fact that we need preschool teachers and children's teachers when I read this. I'm sorry, I tried not to say it out loud, but I can't help it. I can't help but think about that. He's calling the audience out. He's calling them out, and he's saying every believer needs to grow up. 1 Corinthians 13:11, we talk about that being the love chapter, right in the middle of that. Verse 11 says, when I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. One commentator said it this way. Just because we're born again doesn't mean we need to stay babies forever. Then he goes into a conversation about living on milk in verses 13 and 14. And he talks about the difference between milk and solid food. So here's kind of a breakdown of what he's getting at in regard to that. Milk is equal to, when he's talking about the milk, when you're on milk, or you're still taking in milk, he's talking milk is equal to those elementary truths that we mentioned before, the basics of Christianity. Here's an example of what that might be. Sin is bad. God is good. I give deacons in training here, getting ready to go through deacon ordination process, and you know, they got to go through the grilling, I think is what the deacons usually call that. I think they're just trying to scare them. I don't know. It's really been anybody ever actually got burned or anything. But I always say, when they say, what, any advice? I say, yeah, just remember, this is the simple truth. Just remember this. We're for God and we're against sin. But don't get it backwards. Those elementary truths that sin is bad, that God is good, that Jesus is the Savior and we need to follow him, those are great truths. But those are basic elementary truths. That's the milk. The solid food, on the other hand, it says in verse 13, those are teachings about righteousness. That's what we ought to be getting into, not those basic truths, because they're true and they're always going to be true. We don't need to keep learning them over and over and over again. But there are teachings of righteousness that we need to learn about. Verse 14 goes on and talks to them about they train themselves to distinguish between good and evil. Those are the deeper truths. It's actually got less to do with the deeper truths, but putting those truths into action, to living those out, just like Jesus did. He learned obedience by being obedient, by actually doing it. Not just saying I'm going to do it, but actually doing it. The solid food is that those deeper truths, those things that are a little harder, it's about what's right, the difference between good and evil, and then living that out, letting that be what we do. Not that we just hear it, let it go out in one ear and out the other, but we start to take it to heart and we start living that out. We begin to live a life of faith. We're transformed. We're growing. We're changing. We're being more like Jesus every day and not just rocking along doing that. So here's the picture that he's drawing for the readers or the listeners to that sermon. He says, if you're drinking milk, you're still a baby. You're going back to those basic truths. There's no transfer, no transformation. There's no maturity. You need others to direct your every spiritual move, that you just keep being told the same things and kind of encouraged to actually live out those things, but you just have to keep doing it over and over and over again. On the other hand, if you're taking in solid food, then you are mature. You're growing. You know more of God. Not more about Him, even, which also is true, but you know more of Him. There's a connection there. You hear His voice. You hear Him speaking. Again, the theme of Hebrews. And you act on that. You let it come into your life and you act on it. He's guiding you in your spiritual and your moral decisions. Somebody else doesn't have to do that. Holy Spirit is there guiding you because you've learned to connect and to hear that voice and to respond to it. And then you are training yourself, which is our part of that. You're training yourself to study in obedience, just like Jesus did, to live out God's call on your life. That you're not just kind of sitting there, but you're actually doing the things that God has called you to do. So the question is, what's on your spiritual diet? Is it milk? Or is it steak? As humans, as parents, we want our kids to grow up. Sometimes we say we don't. You know, I'm going to put a brick on your head, you're growing too fast, or I wish you could be my baby forever, but nobody really wants that. We want our kids to grow up, to mature, and to live out the life that they have before them. We want them to get graduate kindergarten, graduate eighth grade, graduate high school, graduate whatever after high school, and to go and live their life and be the person God calls them to be. We want that for our kids, don't we? God wants that for His kids as well, us. He wants us to grow up. He wants us to mature. He wants us to go out and live and do the things that He created for us to do. That's His desire for us. So here's the takeaway from Hebrews 5. Jesus is our high priest, our mediator. He is extra qualified to do that. He mediates between us and God, and He helps us to hear. He helps us to hear God's call in our life. The question is, are we listening? Are we listening to His call? Or are we slow to learn? Are we stopping our listening process too quickly before He finishes what He's trying to say to us? Are we content to rock along as babies in Christ over and over and over again? It's a good question for us to take to God right now. Let's listen in these next moments as the Holy Spirit speaks to us. We're going to come now to our time of invitation. If you want to bow your heads and close your eyes and just let the truth of God's Word sink in. What Holy Spirit spoke to you this morning. And as always, it may have nothing to do with Hebrews 5. It may have nothing to do with anything that came out of my mouth. God may have a whole different thing He's speaking to you, but He is speaking to you this morning. What is He saying? What is He saying? And are you going to listen? Or are you going to get up and walk off before He's finished talking? God may be speaking to you this morning that you need to nail down your relationship with Him. That you've never taken advantage of the fact that Jesus has paved the way for you to have a right relationship with God the Father. You've never given your life to Christ. If you're here today and you've not done that yet, please come and let us help you nail that down. So you can know that you know that you know that you have that relationship solid. God's stirring someone's heart somewhere to help teach the children. Or one of a million other things God may be calling you to do in the body of Christ, in your community. Listen. maybe here this morning, and all this stuff is just blurry because there's something going on in your life that's so overwhelming that you can't hear clearly because that's consumed you, and you need someone to pray with you. May or may not change the situation, but it can certainly help you begin to hear God's voice again in your life. If you need someone to pray with you, when we stand this moment saying, you come, we have folks that will be happy to pray alongside of you. And as always, if you need to plant your life in this congregation, this family, we would love to have you come during this invitation. We'll figure out how to make that happen. I'm going to pray. God's going to keep speaking. He's going to keep speaking. And he's going to keep speaking. He's waiting for us to listen and to obey. Precious Father, we thank you that you're faithful to keep on talking. You're faithful to keep coming at us with your love and with your truth. You're faithful to draw us up close. God, learn and help us to learn. Help us to learn to listen. And then to obey. In these next moments, we surrender all of our misgivings, all of our anxieties, all of our fears, all of our worry about what other people are going to think. We surrender all that to you. We ask that your Spirit will come and move in a way that changes lives. God, whether anybody gets up from their seat or not, God, that we would surrender to you and we let you be in charge and we continue to be obedient. We ask these things and we thank you for them ahead of time in Jesus' name. Amen. The standless worship, you come as God leads you to come.
Come out of sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy. Thank you.
Amen. That's good worship right there. Come as you are. That's kind of how we have to come to the Lord, isn't it? Amen. If you think you got to put on your pretty face and your happy face or whatever to come to Jesus, you don't. You just come to Him as you are. He'll take care of all that other stuff. I'm going to have whichever part of the Beal family wants to come. If you want to have a seat for just a second, that'd be fine. They're going to give us a report on Miss Cheyenne because you've been asking. So they're going to answer.
She loves to talk.
That's untrue.
Anyway, that was going to go. Lots of people asking about Cheyenne. Thank you guys so very much for that. She did get her surgery 2 weeks ago, Tuesday. So coming up on 2 weeks. We did pray for her. She's really, it's harder than she thought it was going to be. They did take out the gallbladder and the appendix both, and the doctor said it was a success, and both were obviously a problem for her. As soon as they got in there, they knew they both needed to go right away. So that's a blessing, a praise. God is awesome, and He's blessed her in that answer. So hopefully, once she starts to recover, then that will answer the prayer for being sick and nauseous all the time. She was able to finally start eating a full meal. Without being sick. So, yes. Praise God. Hallelujah. Trying to figure out now how to eat foods without grease, because the gallbladder is the grease catcher, and now without that, it's a whole different type of issue for her. She is at home this morning. She's gradually getting there. She's got up and around. She's been able to walk a lot, and she's forcing her tiny mom's trying to push her to keep moving and stuff like that, because there's 5 different incisions where they went in different places. But she's developed a little bit of a cough with some mucus type stuff, and so that cough is ripping the stuff loose again, and so she's just in a lot of pain. And so that's why she didn't come this morning. Continue in prayer for her. Amen. We thank you.
If you're good to go to pray for Cheyenne, raise your hand. All right, now do it. All right. Good. Good. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Richard, come on down. Richard Johns is our deacon of the week. He's going to lead us in prayer in just a second. So go ahead and stand back up on your feet. We can do this a bunch of times to get our aerobics in, but we won't. We won't. Yeah, get some exercise in. Thank you for being a great church family. We've had lots of our families losing loved ones over these last weeks, and you have been very, 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 very faithful, not just to be here for the memorial services, but to have food at the house and all those kinds of things. And each and every one of them has talked about what a beautiful thing it is to be a part of the body of Christ, to be a part of the family. So whatever you're doing, keep it up. It's working, okay? Good job. And when we get done in this service, we're going to march ourselves to
Sunday school.
Oh, music to my ears. Richard, pray us out of here, brother.
Bow me in prayer, with you. Father in heaven, we humbly come before you, praising the name of Jesus, above every name. Lord, you got to be with us these times. We know your very presence is comforting ones that need you so closely at this time. Forgive us in our sinful ways, Lord. We know we live in this world of trauma and just loss. All over the world is going on. This time, a very troubled time in our world. But you're always in control. And we look to you to help all the ones around us, our family especially, like this. We pray to you for the ones that do not know. Help us all to reach out to ones that maybe never go to church, maybe no one's personally ever contacted with them. It's vital that they know that you love, you are salvation, Jesus. Thank you for your very presence with always. Comfort all those in sorrow at this time, the one that needs your comfort at this time, and pain and such. Thank you, Lord, for your love for us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Let's go. I heard it all.
Yeah, I would say.